This is EdTech, the monthly look at the education market for the audiovisual industry. My name is Tim Albright. I'm your host. Welcome. If you're watching this live, it's election day, so go vote, Americans. If you're in Canada, I have no idea when yours is. With us, as always, Ernie Bailey from UAMS in the great state of Arkansas. How are you, sir?
Tim, I'm doing great.
Awesome. Also with us is Greg Brown. From sunny California, UCLA, go Bears.
Yeah, probably leading the race for the craziest state political situation.
Why is that? Is crazy
very... Sacramento's just like a basket case of full of idiots and no money and, yeah.
You know, don't talk to me about no money. I live in Illinois, all right? I live in Illinois where our last two governors are still serving time, so.
This is true. We don't have that distinction.
You don't have that distinction. So. And we have a new guy, so you two be nice to him. His name is Mike Tomei. He is from Ithaca College, and I can't spell Ithaca, apparently, in the email I sent everyone. So how are you, sir?
Good. Thanks for having me on.
Absolutely. Tell folks a little bit about yourself or about Ithaca, if you would, please.
Sure. Ithaca College is a private college in central New York. We have about 6,700 students. We have about 300 different, I would say, spaces or rooms on campus that have AV installed, so we keep pretty busy. My job is to handle system design and project management. For all of our AV installs, we use installers for the actual installations. And before I worked at Ithaca, I worked at Harvard University for 7 years in their largest AV support department. And I'm the father of two boys, a two-year-old and a two-month-old, so keep super busy with them. And most importantly, I've never missed an episode of this podcast. So,
wow.
Yeah.
That's yeah, Mike is our dedicated listener.
He is the one.
Yes.
The dedicated listener.
The one.
Well, and right. I will say that I think Silverman started listening after he got off the show. So.
Really?
I don't know. I like to think so. I mean, I've never asked him point blank. I have called him a couple times. I'm digressing. He works for Crestron now, and I've called him a couple times about those. Anyhow. All right, let's kick this off.
He returns your calls?
He does return my calls. Does he not return your calls?
I emailed him a time or two, but I think he's upset with me about, well, we won't go there.
What on earth could he... You took over the Technology Managers Council and saved him from that fate. What on earth could he possibly be upset with?
Oh, never mind.
All right, let's kick this show off. From Commercial Integrator, AMX Innova DVX passes the JITC, or JITC testing. The long story short on this, and the reason I'm bringing this up, JITC, by the way, if you don't know what that is, JITC is the Joint Interoperability Test Command testing put on by the United States government. And long story short, basically means that the Innova can be put into governmental installations and high-security governmental installations. The reason I'm asking and bringing this up on an education-focused podcast is whether or not it matters for the education market, right? Whether or not something of that level security matters. So, Ernie, you guys have got UAMS, not for nothing, is University of Arkansas for Medical Services. Medical. Anybody ever heard of HIPAA? Yes. So, you know, Ernie's got some security issues to contend with. Does this matter for guys like you, Ernie?
It does not really matter for us, especially, you know, our stuff is all on the education side. I'm not that much on the health science side of our campus. But this would not be a selling point for me. I mean, if I was using the product anyway, if it met my other needs, it could be considered a bonus.
Yeah.
But I don't see it something that our HIPAA office would require or anything like that. So.
Interesting. Mr. Brown, you don't have the same security concerns. But kind of like Ernie, if you were already using it, could it be a value added? Or is it just one of those that it's not something that you look at?
My I had the opportunity to run this past my Crestron A+ rep, and she gave me the pithy comeback of the week, which was, yeah, well, it still doesn't do 4K and it's more expensive. Beyond okay, that,
so no, hang on, I'm going to come back with a pithy one. I don't know your rep, so
the lovely Brenda.
Do you have 4K that you need? I mean, I'm just asking.
4K. Don't get me started. We're back in the technical backwaters of progress.
Greg is still pushing on VCRs, just so you know.
We're what?
Greg is still pushing VCRs.
We have built one VCR-less room now. This summer.
Okay. So you're saying that the university UCLA.
Yes.
Like one of the biggest colleges in California, as we biggest states in the union, has only one single non, meaning one that does not have a VCR in its campus.
My group, which handles the largest pool of the rooms, the general assignment rooms.
And how many of those rooms do you have?
Just shy of 200.
So 1/200th of your rooms does not have a VCR in it.
Well, this was a large room purpose built. There are some small rooms. Are there some small rooms without VCRs? Then actually there may not be anymore. I think yes. I think yes. One of our rooms now we have built without a VCR.
We're not even putting DVD players in anymore.
Yeah, see.
Yeah, we're not, yeah, like I said, we're kind of dog paddling in the technical backwaters here, you know.
So this security level does not concern you, is what you're saying.
Security? What security?
Exactly. Security. 4K. Who cares?
The VCR is still there the next morning. That's security. It's actually probably not much of a theft target anymore.
No, probably not the DVD player either. To Ernie's point.
Yeah. Oh, actually, they're nice combo decks, to be honest.
Oh well, there you go. All right, Mike, we're going to give you your first crack here. Does this level of security concern either you guys at Ithaca or any other? You also said you worked at Harvard, so I would imagine that's, you know, someplace on that campus they would care about security.
Yeah, probably more so at Harvard, I would say. At Ithaca, we just don't have any programs that require that kind of security. It looked pretty locked down when I was reading about it. They don't allow that device to go on the network. It's really kind of a standalone unit. So I guess you could put any old piece of AV equipment standalone in a room, and it's as secure as what they're saying. So it's, but not something that we really seek out, that level of security.
Yeah, that's actually a really good point. On AV Week last week, I brought this same story up, and something that a control manufacturer's rep told me about a year or so ago, that we don't need to worry about security because nobody wants to break into, hack into, you know, a processor. I said that, and the host of our new show, POE, Tony Zotti, balked at that. He said, you know what, if it's got an RJ40, if it's on the network, somebody somewhere is going to get bored or wants to hack into it. So, you know, to Mike's point, yeah, that's one way to keep it secure, is to keep it off the network.
Oh yeah, we were working with our IT folks to figure out some weird anomalies we were getting, and they gave us basically a run of the things that were pinging some of our devices, and there was all sorts of stuff coming from like China and North Korea and stuff like that, that was like, you know, hitting our gear. Wasn't able to do anything, but it was like, hey, is there something here we can mess with?
Yeah.
It was actually kind of weird to follow some of the IP addresses back to, you know, weird North Korean sites and things like that.
Interesting.
Somewhat disconcerting.
It is a little disconcerting, you know, and as, you know, here's the thing, as the internet gets bigger and bigger and more of our things gets put online, we need to worry about security. I did disagree, to the rep that told me that, and I said, you know, you guys really probably should consider, you know, some sort of encryption, right, some sort of security measures, because as they try to get into other markets, right? They try to, you know, handle HVAC. They try to handle lighting. They try to handle security. A lot of them can. It becomes a target, right? And a lot of, you know, AMX, Crestron, a number of them are going after, you know, whole building automation, right?
Right.
That has to be secure. I'm sorry. You have to have some security on that.
Yeah.
Now, yes, getting it off of the internet and just keeping it, you know, in house is one way. But, you know, eventually somebody somewhere is going to be able to hack into it.
Yeah, I don't think this JITC really has is much of an issue as far as higher ed goes. But I think it's a good move. You know, anytime you see a company like this that's you know, making that little extra effort to kind of, you know, carry the banner forward of, in this case, you know, security and that aspect, you know, it's a good thing. So I poke fun at them, but I think it's a good move on their part.
Yeah. All right. Moving on. Panasonic has a new ultra short throw lens. This is the ultra short throw is something that has kind of come into vogue the last few years because, let's be honest, there are a few things worse than standing in front of a classroom and having, you know, the wonderful projector bulb shine through your head. The one thing about this, though, and Greg shot me this, and we'll start with him on this. Let's see if I can't share it. It only goes on really big projectors. It's for large venue projectors. It really is. I was at an AVI Systems event in October, and actually got to see this in action, and the footprint of the projector. It was a large venue projector, so you know, that size was very interesting, sitting on the ground, shooting up at this screen. So, Greg, is this a good move forward? Do you think maybe this is something that they're putting out there, hopefully to kind of work into their smaller stuff?
They already have small short throws. I think this fills a really interesting niche in that, one of the problems if you do short throw projectors, and I struggled with this in a project just recently, is they're generally small and dim. They're little throwaway projectors. Generally, there's very little on the fancy end or on the, you know, brighter, more nicer projector end. In fact, I did something here I haven't done in like 16 or 17 years. I installed a Sony video projector.
Wow.
Last month. Yeah. When I got here 17 years ago, we were, you know, a sea of Sony three-gun CRTs. And, you know, next thing you know, poof, they're all gone. And they're all, you know, we all went to LCDs and LCOS and stuff like that. And DLP and Sony really was just, you know, Sony made crappy projectors for a lot of years in there. Let's cut to the chase. But the reason I went with the Sony was it was bigger and brighter than anything else out there. It also had horizontal and vertical adjustment, which is literally not available in virtually any other short throw projector. It was a wonderful projector. Of course, you know, no sooner did I buy one than they discontinued that model. But, you know, there goes Sony again. But I give Panasonic a lot of credit for this because, yeah, this goes into, like, you know, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 lumen projectors. And if you need to do something big and bright from a short distance, and, you know, that can make, you know, some of these auditorium installs a whole lot easier when you're not out there, you know, 20 feet above the seats trying to, you know, do some sort of lift escapade. So I give them a lot of credit for doing this. You know, I wish we had more stuff like this out there. I hope they sell a good number of them.
Yeah.
Make it worthwhile.
Absolutely, because then they won't discontinue it.
Exactly.
Mike, is this something, or short throw something that you guys are starting to do at Ithaca?
No, well, you know, I think the only short throws that I buy are on interactive whiteboards. So they're small, you know, 3,500 lumen projectors. And I agree that these are placed on their 7,000 lumen projectors that they have, which we have a few of these in our large lecture halls. We don't use the short throw lens, though. And I just couldn't really see a need for having that bright of a projector at that short of a throw. But I could see it being used in, like, say, museums where you have people standing right in front of what you're hoping to project, or digital signage where you need a much brighter projector at a short throw there. But, you know, I've always, everyone's experienced this with short throws. You really need an extremely flat surface to project onto because of the angle the light is hitting the screen. And this is an extremely short throw, so you must really, really need a flat surface. So I can't see it. You'd have to have some sort of tension screen or a flat wall that you're projecting onto for this to really work.
Yeah, I'm actually going to bring, I think we mentioned this last time, I'm doing a project for, or my company's doing a project for Ernie, and I'm going to bring that project in here. Ernie has a big lecture hall. He has three of them that we're doing, but one of them is rather big. He has two huge projectors, very large venue projectors. So Ernie, in that space, is this something that would make a little more sense where you could, because of the distance between the projector and the screen, you could maybe come down a lumen or two if you're doing a short throw, or does that not make sense? Because to Mike's point, it has to be a very flat screen. It would have to be more.
Yeah, it would have to be a flat screen, and we do not have a tension screen in that room. And you know, we have an ultra wide screen for dual images. So we learned early on that it's not a stable screen at all times. A little bit of wind movement, you know, air handling kick in a little bit wrong, and the screen starts swaying, and that would be amplified with the short throw lens like you're talking about there. The other two lecture halls that you're doing for me, you know, we have shorter throw lenses, but we're still folding with mirrors on rear projection. That might be an application for this, but I still prefer doing it the old-fashioned way with the mirrors to fold the image and make it use a little bit longer lens. They're a little bit more forgiving, easier to work with. So, you know, I like seeing them come out with a lens that'll work in more than one projector. I go back to the days of slide projectors. I'm sure Greg's probably about to putting slide projectors in classrooms now. Is that right? But, you know, it didn't matter what brand slide projector you bought. The lenses were interchangeable, and the lamps were interchangeable. You know, you had a slide projector lamp, and it worked in the Kodak, it worked in the Elmo, it worked in the Bell & Howell, it worked in the Singer. And the lenses would work in all of them as well. And, you know, there were several manufacturers of lenses that you could get depending on what quality you wanted. I wish we would see that again in the projector market, especially in the medium range projectors. But I've screamed that for 20 years, so we're not going to get it.
Well, some brands do that across their line. I mean, we are not to shill for Panasonic. There are some other companies also that are doing this, but we have a lot of Panasonics, and both our small and our mid-size projectors. So you're talking, what, 4,000 and 6,000 lumens? The lamps, lenses, and filters of the current models are backwards compatible with the ones used for the previous model, or actually not completely. The lamps you buy for the newer projectors will also work in the older projectors. They're a little bit different lamp. I've seen some companies move in that direction, and I think that's a start.
Okay.
Did we lose Tim?
Here he comes. He's coming back.
Coming back.
Are you back?
I am.
Okay.
What happened?
I don't know. I tested my network. I was getting all sorts of different websites, and just for some reason, Hangouts decided to not work. So
we can't proceed without adult supervision.
That's what Mike's here for.
Oh, okay. Right. As long as we've clarified that role.
Yeah.
Actually, let me just throw in quick the one application where I saw I don't know where it was, but where I saw this short throw projector used, it was a retrofit install in an auditorium where you had boards, you know, down at board level. You had a screen up above it, and what it let them do was put the projector on the wall above the boards, project up onto the screen, such that your projector is mounted at like 9 feet fixed on the wall, as opposed to, you know, suspended over the audience somewhere. Much simpler install.
That makes sense. Is that one of those things where it's more the chalkboard is down here at the bottom, and then the screen is above it?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think it was a fixed. I think it was a framed screen fixed on the wall type install.
Okay. Yeah, I like that. All right, let's move on to the cloud and not the ethereal little, you know, programming cloud.
We don't have any clouds out here. It's sunny all the time.
No, what, Mike? Okay, so Mike, you said you've listened to every episode.
Yes.
This is what we have to put up with, you know.
Whenever we're buried in snow here or 20 degrees, it's always hard to hear.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Although this is my big stupid dumb American dub Midwesterner. How close to the north? How far up north is Ithaca?
It's dead center of the state, pretty much. So we're just south of Syracuse.
Okay. Yeah. Great.
Everybody hears New York and they think we're, you know, close to New York City, but not very.
No, there's Buffalo, there's Syracuse, there's actual farms in New York that you people don't know about.
We're in farm country, yeah.
So. I actually grew up south of Rochester.
Yeah, that's right.
I thought you grew up in California.
No, I am a native. I was born out here, but then
you grew up.
as much as I have, part of it done in upstate New York, so I know what that fluffy white stuff that comes in the winter is like.
Well, we have
that's why he lives there. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. That's why I live here. I have shoveled snow.
All right. No, I was wondering because, you know, since Mr. Tyner has left us, I didn't know how far north we were able to get. So
yeah, the dog sledding jokes will now be made at Mike's expense.
Right.
All right, so the cloud is a product, is a cloud 40, it's the cloud 4-zone integrated mixer amplifier. It actually reminds me of an Ashley product that they came out with a few years ago. And the reason I wanted to bring this up, and Ernie, we'll start with you, when you've got areas like, let's say a tiered classroom, right, and, you know, you've got speakers, the speakers are kind of going up here, and you've got different distances, I guess, is the best way to put this, between the audience and the speaker, you obviously have to have different audio levels. So is this kind of all-in-one product where you've got a mixer and the amplifier and everything all built in, or do you guys prefer really to kind of break things out and have kind of an audio processor which actually feeds your amplifier, which then feeds your speaker?
I would much prefer to have a DSP in the system. I see too many user-accessible knobs for a system like what you were just talking about. Mm-hmm. It's not going to last. You know, your settings are not going to last. The money you spend in engineering is going to be gone as soon as, you know, somebody comes in and bumps it or decides to play or, hey, I can make it sound better. We've all had technicians like that I know they paid the engineer, but I think I can improve it a little bit and just start turning a couple of knobs and throws the whole system off. I want it all done inside the box.
Okay. Mike, for as far as your guys' rooms, do you, and does it depend whether or not, obviously, you've got a conference room or a large lecture hall or maybe even a smaller classroom where something like this would make sense or kind of like Ernie, where you would rather have an actual dedicated DSP that then feeds everything else?
I think in a classroom or a lecture hall, I would just put a DSP in there. Make it much easier on the support end of things. I agree, too many knobs. I think we would probably use something like this maybe in our dining halls where they need some multi-zone audio. It's not a crucial situation where if somebody makes an adjustment, it's not like class isn't going to happen. And it's cheaper than putting a DSP in there and some sort of a control surface for them. Actually, our health center, they want to do multi-zone audio for, they have three or four different waiting rooms, that students go and wait in before they see doctors and nurses. So they want to do some multi-zone. Something like this might work in there just for music playback. But in a classroom, I would put a DSP in there. And, you know, if you really need to, you know, tap 70-volt speakers at different wattages to get different levels, something along those lines. But I probably wouldn't use it in a classroom.
Okay. All right, Mr. Brown, you're the last word on this. Is this an all-in-one system like this make sense for you guys?
Once again, bringing up the old-school contingent.
Yes.
Representing the old school contingent. Hey, I like my knobs. You don't like knobs? They're these things called security covers and tamper-proof hardware. We're using something like this. We aren't using this particular mixer amplifier. We're using a separate amplifier and zone mixer because we're using it for something you guys are completely not thinking about. You know, we have to think out of the box a lot of times, and what we ended up with here, and yet in retrospect, this was something we came up with a few years ago. And if we had to do it again today, yeah, I'd look long and hard at DSP. I'm a DSP box of some sort, although I'm willing to bet this is probably cheaper than a DSP box and an amplifier. What we ended up with was in a lot of rooms where we had not only our mono PA and our stereo program, we also had to deliver a line output feed for instructors such that they could plug in and record. We had our feed to our podcasting and webcasting systems, and we also had the feed to the infrared hearing assist, and we ended up with a situation where we had to be able to pull out some of the sources from some of those, because we, you know, like we didn't want to record like you know, VCR and DVD material into the webcast material because there's licensing issues, things like that. We had to come up with all these different, possibly come up with all these different permutations of what had to be in what mix, and so we went with a four zone mixer because it gave us the little dip switches such that we could very easily tick in or out a particular source in a room if we needed to change the mix in a particular setup, in a particular room for that quarter. And it's worked out really well. It's given us a lot of flexibility and, you know, been a really good situation. Like I said, yeah, we'd probably look long and hard at DSP today, but, you know, it's been inexpensive, reliable, and worked well. You know, I can't complain. I think it's a neat product.
Yeah.
Niche product, but a neat product.
I'm as you're describing this, I'm thinking, okay, that would take me about 2 seconds, maybe three, in a DSP program.
Yeah.
However, to your point, it doesn't allow a lot of flexibility because you either have to create a bunch of presets or
exactly
hire somebody to come in every semester and reprogram it. So
and you know, 3 years ago or so when we were doing this, we didn't have any sort of familiarity with DSP at all. I since have gotten a little bit, haven't actually programmed one, but I'd be willing to give it a try. But yeah, like you said, you know, it's aimed at a little bit different type of application than what we did. The little dip switches work out fine for us.
All right, from Higher Ed Tech Decisions, the SIA and the NSCA are putting together new guidelines for school safety, and if you're not familiar with the NSCA is, or the SIA, Security and Industry Association, and NSCA is obviously the National Systems Contractors Association. They're putting together some stuff to help guidelines for electronics security and life safety in schools. So we'll go around the horn here and see what do they need to include, right? What is it, from your guys' experience and your standpoint, what is it that we need to make sure that they don't forget about? Ernie, from your standpoint for life safety and for, you know, school security, what should they make sure that they include in some of these guidelines?
Well, excuse me, it looks like they're looking mostly at K-12 programs here. So if that's where you're going, you know, door security, monitors. But an issue we're seeing here recently is they're putting cameras on school buses, you know, for catching people passing stop school buses. We've had 2 children killed this semester in the state of Arkansas. And it's really leading to a big push to put monitor cameras and automatic prosecution rules in place for any car passing a school bus. But they've got to be able to track it. You know, you can't just take the bus driver's word and, you know, 7 cars passed me today and I got 3 of the license plates. Doesn't work.
Yeah.
So I think something like that for student safety is good. But and like I said, you know, you need cameras, monitors at doors, magnetic latches, things like that. You know, those are things that I kind of think about. We have classrooms that we can lock down. You know, if we on our campus, if there's word of an active shooter, we can hit a button in some of our lecture halls. It will lock the doors. Nobody can get in. You can get out if you have to, but nobody can get in without a key and the release being let go. It grabs the door so they lock. We don't have it in all of our rooms. We do have it in some, but, you know, something like that, I think, is if you're looking at the technology side of it.
Where do you initiate that lockdown button from? Is it from inside the classroom?
Inside the classroom, we have 2 buttons in the classrooms. In fact, 2 of the rooms that your team is working on for us right now, we have 1 button beside the lectern on the wall right behind the lectern and 1 right by the main entrance doors. So a student can get up and push it real quick if the announcement was made.
Okay. All right, Mike, from your standpoint, what are some of the things that the NSCA should make sure they don't miss on these guidelines?
I guess on the AV end of things, obviously, emergency messaging in the classrooms using existing AV systems or digital signage, that sort of thing. We don't do a lot of that at the moment. We're getting our digital signage network up and running in the near future. But there's a lot. It's very hard because there's a lot of different contractors that are involved. You have AV contractors, electricians, life safety, or security contractors. So when new buildings are being built, a lot of different building management systems or AV remote management systems are put into place, and there's not a lot of integration between them. So it's always hard to integrate those systems and have emergency messaging that's simple to use in a situation.
Is that something where, because I ran into that when I was a technology manager, with you have all these different systems, right? They had a system that would text people, that system that would, you know, flash up on the screen on the desktop in the classroom. How do you think we go about, Greg, we'll kick it off with you on this one. How do we go about making sure that all these disparate technologies and all these disparate integrators kind of get together and say, hey, let's come up with one good solid system here that is simple to use, like Mike said, but is able to contact everybody at one fell swoop?
I think this is why we're going to see a real growth in standards going down the road. I think the only way to fix a lot of these problems is to beat a lot of these people into submission. You know, it's something I've been involved, I've mentioned the standard I've been involved with, the AV and IT infrastructure guidelines for higher education, coming either here at the end of the year or the beginning of next year. And yeah, it's something we've talked and gone around with a lot. There are so many things that go on in any project where, you know, the left hand doesn't talk to the right, you know, the fingers don't talk to one another. Everybody is off in their own direction and do their little part and don't talk with the other people they need to. I mean, I liked Mike's answer, but yeah, you know, same thing here with, we have digital signs all over the place, and it's literally coordinated by the department that owns that particular section of wall, and you can walk down a corridor and you'll see 3 or 4 different monitors, and they're all 3 or 4 different makes, and they're all 3 or 4 different you know, makes of monitors and makes of mounts and doing completely different things or not doing things. I think right now my personal, the personal record for outdated digital signage on campus right now is a little over 3 years. There is a series of digital signs over in North Campus that are still running material from the fall of 2011. Hmm. So,
but is it still relevant? I mean, you know, you don't have to change it every semester, do you?
Well, yeah, but there's a time limit to how useful this sort of stuff is. This is like dated, you know, apply for these certain things by this sort of stuff. It's not like, you know, the crawlers or the slideshow of, you know, scientific developments running over in the engineering hall or something like that, which, yeah, doesn't change nearly as fast or isn't as time sensitive. It's applying for particular events and things like that for 3 years ago. So, yeah. You know, they're pretty much almost graduated now by now if that that sign applied to them originally.
Mm. All right.
On that same subject, we looked at it several years ago as far as using the AV systems for the life safety and, you know, storm warnings, things like that. But the deal is it has to work every time. And, you know, what if students are studying in a classroom and the system's turned off? They're not going to get the message at that point unless it turns on the system and waits for it and runs it. So, excuse me, you run into a lot of issues like that. The same reason we have decided not to put the paging announcements that come up through the overhead speakers through the AV systems in the classrooms, but we have a separate speaker in every classroom that covers any type of life safety announcement or anything like that. They're totally, completely separate systems so that, you know, there is one group that's responsible for any type of messaging that goes out, and it's separate, and it works whether the AV system's up or down, class is in place or not, it still comes through. So that's one thing you have to think about is if you're going to use your AV system, you have to have 100% reliability of it, or you're liable for the people who don't get the message because your system failed.
Yeah, you know, I've told the joke about how we spent probably millions of dollars for this Voice of God system, you know, these speakers on select buildings around campus to broadcast at high volume alerts out to the campus overall, and they are almost unintelligible from every location except for, like, you know, right out in front of the particular building that the speakers are on. So the running joke here is we'll have something like a shooter and the speakers will be broadcasting something and we'll all run outside to hear what the speakers are saying and got shot.
Nice. That actually is one of the things that they're looking at when they're updating those standards. Is intelligibility. Yes. It's not just quote-unquote coverage. It's intelligibility, and you've got these electrical contractors now that are looking at this standard going, what the heck is intelligibility? I thought just had to have so many dB for so many feet, and now they're having to work with that.
Oh, yeah, you can hear them, but, you know, I sit here in my office and you know, it's like great big brick buildings all on a nice rectilinear pattern. You know, the reverb is fantastic. It distorts everything. You know, you can't understand a darn thing they say.
Rectilinear.
I think that's the right word, too. I don't know how I stumbled upon that, but, you know, even a broken clock is right twice a day. And this was my minute.
I was going to say, I wouldn't give you twice a day. I'll give you once, maybe. All right, from our old buddy Scott Tyner on the Rave Pubs blog, room view connected displays. And I wanted to bring this up because this is one of the things that, you know, I program restaurant systems. I used to sell them. I used to install them in my classrooms. I've long history with restaurant. This is one of those things, though, that kind of gets me. You've got, and Scott writes about how he was one of the first people to use RoomView, and if you're not familiar with what RoomView is Crestron's fusion now, but RoomView is Crestron's asset management software. Extron has one, AMX has one, a number of people have them. And Crestron has done a very good business model where they've gone to display manufacturers and said, hey, here's our secret sauce code, right? Put this in your display, and you can just jack into our RoomView software. Right, our asset management software, which is great if you have a Crestron system and if you have RoomView. Mike or Greg, we'll start with you on this. If you don't have that, I guess let's say if you don't have any asset management, would something like this RoomView installed, I guess, or RoomView inside or Crestron inside type display, would that entice you to either purchase that display or look at Crestron's asset management system?
Wow. If you don't have any sort of asset management system, I think you are probably part of one of those AV departments that I expect is going to be taken over by somebody else in the not too distant future. The systems are just getting much more complicated. We mentioned building management systems and stuff like that. All of this stuff is going. The line between AV and occupancy and energy management, the temperature, the lights. All of these lines are just going to continue to blur over the next few years. And if you aren't involved with something as basic as asset management, you know, I think somebody's going to eat your lunch here in the next few years. And it also ties in with I think what we talked about in the last show or two, that these programmed control systems, they aren't that bad. Speaking from a school that navigated this transition from, you know, configurable control systems to programmed control systems. Not that there's anything bad with the configured ones. They have their place, you know, generally in small offline rooms, I think. Program systems are becoming, you know, de rigueur. They're not. It's not that bad. It's, you know, if you're not doing programmed systems, and you're listening to how bad they are by a company that doesn't sell programmed systems, yeah. Well, you know, consider your source. You know, you need to kind of get your head out of the sand and learn this sort of stuff and get with the program.
Okay. All right, Mike. From your standpoint, and Greg alluded to this. I mean, is asset management to the point where is it to the point where if you have X number of rooms or if you're X size of an AV department, do you need this? I mean, is this something that is a necessity at this point?
No. I mean, I'm kind of in the same mindset as Greg. You know, that if people are, if they don't have anything set up for remote management, this probably won't matter really to them. They're maybe just doing a couple one-offs here and there, small rooms. But I think I really agree with Scott in that, you know, I really thought this was just a way for people to kind of get these projectors on to their, you know, RoomView Express. I really did not know that it could really change your programming using that module, that RoomView connected module within Simple, to really simplify your programming and make projector swaps pretty easy, actually. So that was pretty interesting. And I'm in the same boat as Greg. We're going through a transition from, like you said, configurable systems to programmed systems. So anything to make the programming end of things easier for us is pretty big, because we spend a lot of money paying programmers to make changes for us when we're using a module like this. I think they call it just Crestron connected now, is that right? It's not necessarily RoomView connected, because I have some Panasonic projectors that have that on there. I'm really going to look into using that module instead of putting all specific serial strings in.
Yeah, and the one thing is, they do say Crestron connected, but years ago it was RoomView connected, and now it's got the little Crestron logo.
Ernie, now the program that integrates it all is actually Fusion.
Yeah, Fusion is the one, and that's, you know, Ernie.
It replaced RoomView, or it's Fusion RV for RoomView. Right. But I mean, we've had Fusion and RoomView before that, and it surprises me that Scott didn't know that. Just knowing Scott and how he works things, but that was one of the selling points when Crestron came and said, you know, we'll work with you on, you know, developing your system and creating a good management tool, you know, providing RoomView and all that. They started out by selling the RoomView connected, as they called it back then, and telling us that when you program the rooms, you use this module, and then it does, as long as the projectors you buy, or back then it was just projectors, now they have flat panel displays as well that have the Crestron inside or Crestron connected. They said, you know, as long as you have a device with that, you don't have to reprogram. You just tell the projector what its IP ID is and what the server's IP address is, and it starts working. You know, your controls start working. So, like I said, I was surprised to see that he hadn't been using it in that way, because we've been doing that for at least 5 or 6 years now. So
you really have to.
We like it.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Mike. You really have to make a commitment to purchasing Crestron connected display devices from that point on. Otherwise, you are going to have to go in and, you know, reprogram and put in strings and that sort of thing.
We made that decision at that point, and a lot of our projectors were not, but we said from this point forward, you know, when we put a bid out, even if we say we'll accept substitutions or alternates, it must have the Crestron connected. It must be on the Crestron connected sheet that Crestron provides, or we will not consider that product. And all of our projectors since then have been there.
Okay, so kind of the way everything's going with HD based T too. You know, if you make that decision to not have a room controller and go directly into a display with HD based T, you're kind of committed to that unless you really cut the room. So
yeah,
but I'm going to ask this question and play devil's advocate here. What's the danger, I guess, of putting all of your eggs in one manufacturer's basket? And this is something that we've talked about on this show before, where, you know, you start going down a certain control road, right? And again, whether that's AMX or Crestron or whoever, when you make the investment in that asset management software, right?
Right.
You are making a commitment to that manufacturer, right? Whether it's RMS from AMX or Fusion from Crestron, you're saying, I'm giving you guys everything I've got, because honestly, you know, if you have room, if you have Fusion, let's say, and you do have, you know, a dozen or so AMX rooms, unless you've got a really, really, really good programmer that knows the back end of AMX, you're not getting that inside Fusion, right?
Right.
So, I mean, what is, and Ernie, we'll start with you on this. What's the danger then of going, you know, putting your faith, I guess, in one manufacturer?
Well, I mean, you are putting your faith in that one manufacturer. You're counting on them staying in business, mm-hmm. And keeping their products current and providing a path for you to be able to keep your systems current. That they will, as they upgrade their management tool, that it still will talk to their older equipment, and their older equipment will continue to work with the systems until you upgrade it. But at the same time, they're also providing the multiple, or I guess any display manufacturer that wants to work with them, the software and maybe some hardware, I don't know, that goes into their device, so they will talk to each other. But it allows us to, you know, we're not one product from start to finish, but we have things that are designed to talk to each other and to work together. So, I mean, anytime you go with a management system that's going to take over your whole system, you're going to be facing the same dangers of, you know, what happens if they go out of business.
So is there, Mike, we'll ask you the same question. I mean, what are some of the dangers of doing this, of putting your putting everything in one manufacturer?
Well, over the past few years, like I said, we've been switching over to a more of a programmable, you know, Crestron-based system. And I feel like we did the research in the beginning to develop our standards, and I'm fine putting my eggs in one basket, because if I can get that support across the entire system, everybody's been in that situation where a manufacturer points a finger at another piece of gear built by somebody else in that system and says, well, there's your problem. But if that projector has Crestron connected features to it, and for some reason you're having a problem with the control system talking to it, well, now we're all in the same boat here, because we're supposed to be able to have that functionality with that projector. So it makes that troubleshooting a little bit easier. So I think if you just do your research in the beginning and develop your standards properly, I have no problem going down that road.
Okay. All right. That makes sense. All right, Mr. Brown, the last one on this one. Is it okay to go down this road and give them everything you got?
Well, I think we don't, to some extent, we don't have a choice. I mean, we are right now running two parallel systems, Global Viewer Enterprise and Fusion. And so, and we probably will be for, you know, a foreseeable number of years, you know, until we retire all of our Extron equipment. But, you know, that's not going to happen overnight. And we've just kind of resigned ourselves to our fence straddling strategy of supporting two for the time being. It's a nuisance, but amongst all the other nuisances that we typically deal with on a day-to-day basis, there are worse nuisances.
Yeah. Okay. The only thing I'm going to ask is, and this is a general question, it's a rhetorical question, I don't expect an answer. Would it be nice if they would allow you a way out, right? A pathway to migrate from one to the other, and I don't know quite how that would work. And I know my friends at AMX and my friends at Crestron are both cringing at that thought. But there was a point in time when a couple of other room management software, asset management software manufacturers, were saying that we don't care who you use, we don't care who the control system is, we will talk to anybody. And they were smaller companies, and they were trying to make a foothold in the industry.
Still out there.
There's still, you know, there's a couple still out there, and I just wish that the bigger players would say, you know, we don't care who your control system is, you know, give us a day, or here's a module, you know, we can talk to anybody.
You gotta realize that to some extent, none of these companies have your best interest in mind. All of these companies want you as their customer and only their customer. Yeah. And they've got you by the proverbial short hairs, and they want to keep you there. And so as much as rosy and as wonderful as that world would be, I don't see anything like that happening. You know, one of these companies won't even show up to world's largest trade show at this point. You know, you think they're going to work with one of the other companies in any way, shape, or form? No. They're only going to do what all of these companies are really only going to do what benefits themselves.
What I was going to say is, on that line, I have expected for years and would still love to see the third-party company not writing the software or anything like that, but come up with the interface box so that my room view system will talk to the AMX controller in one of my older classrooms and get all the feedback that it needs and provide the control that it needs. But, you know, We haven't seen that yet, but I think that we would come closer to seeing that than having AMX, Crestron, Extron make an interface unit themselves that would talk to the other's control system.
So you're saying like a third party?
Yeah, a black guys. Box, you know, yeah. A
black box that talks both, almost right. Like a translator.
Exactly.
All right. All right, guys, last story here, and it's more just a, hey, this is kind of cool because Ernie said this was happening, and it is. Crestron is shipping the DMPS-3. The DMPS-3. So in case you're wondering, or in case you're following along, the MPS came out, oh, good Lord, 7-8 years ago now.
Yeah.
And then the DMPS came out, and then now it's the DMPS-3. That is the 3-series processor of the DMPS line. Pro 3 and AV3 and the MC3 came out about a year or so ago, started shipping, and the 3 series of the DMPSs are shipping now. And one young man on this panel is actually getting ready to order one. Isn't that right, mister?
That's right. I don't know how young two. I am, but...
Two.
Yes. It's a double classroom. We'll be using those as the primary switcher as well as the control system for a larger switch in the back of the room and handling the video conferencing in the room. So,
yeah,
but I'm kind of excited and kind of nervous at the same time because they say it's going to start shipping in 2 weeks. The one that I'm looking at, we're looking actually at the DMPS 3-150, which is actually a 4K device as well. So I'll have 4K to my switch anyway, not any further than the matrix switcher, but it's a first step.
Yeah.
I'm gonna be ordering a DMPS 3-150 also in the not too distant future. For I don't know whether we talked about that or not. That's a fairly trick little device that gets you. That gives you some nice alternatives in smaller rooms than you really had before. It's a little one rack unit device.
Yeah.
It was a real smart move on their part, I think. And this is it's a 25 person computer lab, so it's a fairly small venue. I would consider some other equipment for it, some other more basic stuff for it, but it's got two larger sister labs next door, which are going to be built out probably this summer, that are going to require things like the 300s and stuff like that. And I just want to keep everything, you know, nice and compatible rather than, you know, I don't need three different control systems in three different rooms, much less across campus. Oh, yeah. Variety is the spice of life, right?
That's exactly. Variety is the spice of life. All right, guys, that will do it for this month. I'd like to thank Mike Tomei. Mike is from Ithaca College. Thank you, sir.
Yes, thanks for having me on.
Where can people do you write? Do you tweet? Do you do anything?
If people want to find me, they can find me on LinkedIn. That's probably the best place.
All right, very good. Also with us is Greg Brown from UCLA. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Greg is also the chairperson, at least currently, of the Technology Managers Council. Apparently they're looking for a replacement, so we're all going to nominate Mike. Where can people find you, sir?
Me, LinkedIn and at AV Greg for Twitter. And I will be returning back to Infocom All Voices here soon, as soon as I finish up my standards task force obligation. Yes. And also blog here on AV Nation at some point here in the, I hope, not too distant future. So
just send it to me, dude.
Yeah, as soon as I get a free moment.
Yeah, good luck with that. All right, last but not least, Ernie Bailey from UAMS in Arkansas. Thank you, sir.
I'm glad to be here.
And where can people find you?
You can find me on LinkedIn.
LinkedIn, all right. My name is Tim Albright. Don't try looking for me. I'm not very interesting. I tweet about football and stuff. So, but go by the website if you would, please, avnation.tv, avnation.tv. You'll find this program and a host of others. I made mention that we have a new program. We have two, actually. One is hosted by Tony Zotti, talking about AV networking. very, very smart show. I got the chance and the pleasure to sit behind the scenes of the first one, and I learned an incredible amount. And then also our old buddy Phil Cordell, Hi-Fi, is doing the technology rap. If you are a fan of the rap genre and a fan of AV news, give him a listen or a view every week. He'll take about 2 minutes of your time, and he will rap. Yes, he will rap the AV news of the week. So check out that episode from last week. It was very cool. So AVNation.tv, AVNation.tv. Thanks so much for listening. Thanks so much for watching. This has been EdTech.